sauce, though.
Yes. For this recipe, you would need 1 cup of brainwash, 1 tablespoon of degrading music, 1 pinch of self-esteem to keep them perky, and 1 man trapped in a world of male superiority. Allow the woman to marinate in a misogynistic society for decades. Be sure to brainwash your woman, erasing any traces of self-worth, because a woman that knows what she is worth is just as good as rotten. Don't allow her to think. Add your tablespoon of degrading music to make sure she always sees herself as object, never human, never woman, only an object to be objectified. Ensure that society sees her as nothing more than body parts. Make her think she's in control, but we all know better. Add 3 cups of coconut oil, because how else could she be hashtag team melanin? The most important ingredient, a man, because woman can never be perfect without him, without master, without head chef, throw in a waist trainer. Add 2 preserved thighs into the pot, stir, bring to a thickness, because how else could you really make her a snack, stir, bring to a boil, make her angry by dishing out your expectations, stir, and let it simmer. Make her the Barbie in your dreams, stir, and add blame, because why is she being a typical mad black woman? Slide her right off the pot. The cocoa butter makes that easier, so she doesn't stick, so she's hot enough while you eat, because nobody likes to eat cold meals. Disguise wrongs and tell her they are her rights. Force her to stand for them. Force her to stand. Force her to eat. Force this recipe down her throat. It doesn't matter if she doesn't like the flavor. This is society's recipe for the perfect woman. The heat is on every woman that refuses to swallow her womanhood and become a side instead of the main course she is. But I, we, us, women, are done following society's recipe. Never again will we bend over backwards to fit the standards in their measuring cup. We are creating our own recipe, where the only measurements are the ones we set. Society's recipe only poisons our women and girls into thinking they are inferior. But we are made with the finest ingredients. You can't get these ingredients anywhere else, honey boo-boo. So every thick thigh, every thin lip, every strand of straight or curly hair, everybody dipped in chocolate or vanilla is meant to be here. So to everyone who thinks they know what women should be, this is what we are serving now.
Hello, 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 hi. Give it up for Cameron, everybody. She is part of a youth poetry collective called Urban Word NYC. Part of the motivation behind creating this series was to honor women of color, past, present, and future. And of the 3 series with WNYC that we've done thus far, we hadn't done enough to honor the future. And I was lucky enough to be a judge for this slam poetry competition that they had up at the Apollo Theater, and I thought, who better than to have some amazing youth poets be the representation for this future element? So give it up. So thank you guys again for being here for the Sissieretta series. Just a little bit of background on Madam Sissieretta Jones, who is beautifully profiled in this frame. She was a soprano from the late 19th century, early 20th century, and she was regarded as one of the premier vocalists in the world. She traveled all around the world. All these medals that she has on her brooch are from different dignitaries who thought that she was just so amazing that, like, they needed to award her with rubies and diamonds and just these awards to show how much they appreciated her vocals. She was regarded as the Black Patty because there was an Italian singer, Patty, who was white, and they were like, oh, she's as good as this white woman. We'll just call her the Black version, which is awesome, right? But she was singing all around the world. She's the first African-American to sing on stage at Carnegie Hall. She sang for four consecutive presidents, but it wasn't until the fourth one that she was allowed to walk through the front door. And she could not get a contract with any opera house in the States because of the fact that she was Black, regardless of the fact that she's traveling all around the world. She's the highest paid African-American of her time. No opera house wanted to sign her. And so what she decided to do was she made her own vaudeville show, which was one of the main performing elements of the time, called the Black Patty Troubadours. And it was an opportunity for her to give other Black people a stage to perform at that wasn't under the humiliation of minstrelsy, which was one of the main ways that Black entertainers could perform on stage. They had to be in blackface, and that was incredibly humiliating, but that was a way that people could make money. So she decided to make her own vaudeville show, which traveled for about 20 years, and they were incredibly successful. But on top of just giving other performers an opportunity to perform, she also was allowing herself to have a place where she could sing opera, because none of these other places in the States would let her do so on stage. So she decided to create her own platform, not just to help her own career, but to help the career of the people around her. And she's incredibly inspiring. And unfortunately, her mother got cancer after she had been doing this for about 20 years. And so she left the Black Patty Troubadours to help her mom. And after that, she died penniless and not even with a gravestone. People didn't know who she was. She unfortunately was around before recorded music was a thing, so there are no recordings of her, but it's only until recently that people have begun to really give her her flowers, as they say. I found out about her after the New York Times was doing a series on forgotten people of color and women who they didn't give obituaries for. And for those of you who don't know, my grandfather, Robert McFerrin, was the first African-American to sign a contract with the Metropolitan Opera. And as somebody who descended from that legacy, I was ashamed that I didn't know who she was. And so when we were putting this together, the first one was a year ago in January at Come On Everybody in Brooklyn. I wanted to make sure that it was named after somebody who was a trailblazer and was doing this whole for us, by us, before, you know, there was a song about it, before there was a clothing line about it. And she came to mind. And so naming it the Sissieretta series, I'm really honored to honor her and, you know, honor her legacy and just kind of continue the path. So this is a series that is honoring all women of color. And thank you guys for supporting them tonight. I really appreciate it. So the theme of tonight's show is In Her Own Words, which is why we started with poetry. And I thought that it would be cool for me to, as a songwriter, to dissect me writing some music. So if you guys are cool with that, I'm gonna go through some stuff. It's not like your typical performance. I've also never dissected how I write a song before. So you guys are my guinea pigs, and it's gonna be great. But I'm gonna dissect a song from my new EP called Know You Better. It is the only song that I play the piano on, and they got a beautiful new Steinway, so gotta test that out. Apparently, if they plug it in, it'll like be a ghost piano and play it back to you, which we're not gonna do that tonight, but that's a great way to just like scare people in your house, I feel like. But yeah, so where should I put this microphone? Because I'm going to use a different microphone. Ta-da! Thank you. Hello, hello. Same person, new mic. All right. So a little side note, I wrote an album a while ago, and when I started doing solo music,
I decided that I didn't want to perform what I had written because I was not confident enough playing piano and singing in a concert setting. So now I just force myself to do it in front of people. so this is Know You Better.
Tables are turning, must be the speed. So guide me over observing under your lights. So would it be wise to read your mind? Think I might find anything I'd like to know you're deserving. Would you agree? You've got me tossing and turning. Could this be right? So would you advise a free young mind? Think I might find anything I'd like to know you better. Would you let me? To know you better, would you let me? I'd like to know you better, would you let me? Oh, I'd like to know you better, would you let me, let me, let me, let me, let me?
Thank you. So, one thing you should know about me is I have no idea what I am playing, ever. I went to Berklee College of Music, and when I really, really feel the need to, I'll do my best to like go back after the fact and be like, what is this chord? Right? But it definitely takes me much longer than I, in my mind, think I should. But, I always go with what feels nice, and that usually ends up being some kind of jazzy something with like mad tensions. For anybody who doesn't know, so you know, you've got your like 12 tones on the keyboard, and in a scale you have 8, and there's a tension called 9, which is a second, and I have 9s all over the place. It's my favorite. But when I was writing this song, I didn't want to do a loop, which is what it ended up being, because when I do acapella stuff, you gotta do like the same things over and over and over again in order for it to work. You can't really move places, and so something I like about playing the piano is you can kind of dictate other places for it to go, because my favorite thing is when you're listening to a song and then it changes and you get a stank face, you know? Because you're like, man, that I was not expecting that, yes. And so I was trying to force myself to not write in a loop structure, but everything that I tried to do going different places, it wasn't working. So I just gave in to the loop, and it ended up being this like very jazzy thing. I'm trying to not be defined as like a quote unquote jazz artist, and then I keep writing jazz songs. So I don't know what I'm doing. But anytime I write music, I'm always starting with the chords. The chords are always first, and then the melody is always second. And lyrics are last. And so that was part of why I wanted to deconstruct this, because this whole thing is called In Her Own Words, and lyrics for me are very much a continuation of melody. I don't know if anybody, this isn't on purpose, but Paul McCartney, he always has like filler words that he makes before he writes the actual song. So yesterday was scrambled eggs. It was like, scrambled eggs, oh my darling, how I love her legs, or something like that. I don't tend to have like filler words as much as I love Paul. But it's always like sounds and vowels that come into place. And so I had the like, like I knew it was a E sound at that. And little backstory, I wrote this 2 years ago and I had been diagnosed, or not diagnosed, I had been prescribed Adderall that lasted for a month. And so the first line is, tables are turning, must be the speed has got me over observing. And that is a direct line about the fact that I had taken Adderall that day. And that is the speed that I am talking about. But it sounds far more poetic in the like song structure. But just so you know, that is about Adderall. I don't think the song's about Adderall, but it sounded good in the line. It's like over observing under your lights. I like to play a lot with that kind of idea of like, if I say over, I use under. If I say left, I say right. I also oftentimes, when I'm writing, I'll repeat word, either like the start of my verses will be the same, or I'll just use the same idea. And I really liked the idea of I like being the thing that repeats over and over. Connecting the two things, so like got me over observing under your eyes. Would it be wise to read your mind? Think I might find anything I'd like to know you're deserving. So I always like to kind of play with that idea of ending, the ending of a phrase and a beginning of a phrase overlapping. Because then you never know where it's gonna go, you know? I can just dangle you out there and you'll be like, what's happening? And I don't know either. So, you know, it just goes along. And I settled on this idea of like, oh, I'd like to know you better. Would you let me? Because I'm in a wonderful, loving, committed relationship right now. But I have been toyed with several times in my life, and just the idea of wanting to know someone better, you know, the idea of like, I am trying to get through to you, but you are not letting me. And that theme kept coming up. I try and not write as many man-hating songs because I don't hate men. I hate a couple of people. That is not men exclusive. I hate a certain man in the White House, but you know, that's a whole other thing. But just this idea of, I spent a lot of time yearning to like, have people let me in, which was probably, I wasn't letting them in at the same time. So, you know, who's fooling who, right? But I'm always trying to figure out how I can get as much wordplay in as possible. I had a teacher at Berkeley tell me that I put too many words in my songs, and I stop sometimes, but when I create these melodies, it's hard for me to, since I create the melodies first and the words are an extension of the melody, it's hard for me to, If I make a boss melody, I'm like, I gotta fit all of the words possible in the melody. You will hear everything I'm saying. And this is definitely one of those songs. It is definitely one of those songs where I tried to fit in as much as possible. But just in terms, these are all of the lyrics. I won't sing them. It's, tables are turning, must be the speed has got me over observing under your lights. So would it be wise to read your mind, think I might find anything I'd like to know you're deserving? Would you agree? You've got me tossing and turning. Could this be right? So would you advise I free your mind, think I might find anything I'd like to know you better. Would you let me? Would you let me? I'd like to know you better. Would you let me? And funny enough, as a songwriter, people try and get all these deep meanings happening, and lots of times it really is just what flows. It really is just what happens, what feels natural in the moment. Like, I wasn't intending to have a line about me taking Adderall, but that's what happened, you know, and you just go with it. But I really like this song. I'm really proud of it. It's, you know, as soon as I wrote it, I was like, God damn it, that's a jazz song. Like, I was like so mad at myself. But jazz is the root of, like, all popular music, so, you know, can't be mad at it. And it makes me feel musically intelligent, even though I have no idea what I'm playing. But when I play this song live in concert, I don't tend to have a piano with me because this is the only song I play with a piano, so I'm not about to put a piano on my, like, tech writer. Be like, wheel out a piano so I can play this one song. That's not how I tend to roll. So I developed an acapella version, which I can do because it's a loop. So I tried to get away from the loop, but it brought me back. So I'm going to do that in a little bit. But that's kind of like a short gist. But I wanted to know if you guys had any questions. This is an open floor. It can be about my songwriting process. It cannot be about the songwriting process. This is the last Sissieretta series. I might never see you again. You may never get the chance to ask me any questions. So if you have any questions, advice, anything, there is a microphone somewhere. This guy. He's got a microphone. What you got? What you got for me? Yes. Yes. Hello. Oh, wait. Do you want to go to the mic? Should we pass around the mic? How do we want to do this?
I'm really loud.
Oh, that's okay. I mean, yeah, if you want to. Well, I think maybe for the stream.
Two. Mic two.
Hello.
Hi. Vanessa. Hi, Vanessa.
I want to know, like, you know, everyone gets stuck when they're, like, songwriting sometimes. Like, it happens. Like, but do you ever think, like, oh, I need this, like, new section, I need, like, something different, and, like, how do you get through that?
Totally. That is a great question as it pertains to this song, because, like I'd mentioned, I was trying to get away from the loop idea, and I probably had the chord, just what ended up being the loop, for about a month before I finally committed to it, because I kept trying to go other places. I kept forcing myself to be like, you don't want to do a loop, like, just do something else, like, go somewhere else. And it, as soon as I let go of that idea, everything else came into play. Like, I think I had that chordal structure for like a month and a half, 2 months, and once I let go of it, I think I wrote the whole song in like an hour. You know, it was just one of those things where it was like, once I gave up on what I thought I needed it to be, when I stopped forcing myself to have some idea. I mean, it is good to force yourself to step out of your comfort zone in terms of writing in general, but sometimes you just kind of have to let it happen. My favorite songs that I've written, I shouldn't necessarily say my favorite, but a lot of my favorite songs that I've written have been the quickest ones, and that's not why it's my favorite, but it's been so clearly like, oh, this is just such an organic thing that's flowing through me that it just happens, you know? And I feel like that tends to happen more so when I stop forcing it to be something else, or when I stop forcing myself to try and be something else. I love a musical challenge. I mean, any kind of challenge is always welcome, because that's how you grow as a person and as a songwriter. But when I get to those points of being stuck, I walk away, I come back. Or sometimes I switch up my modes. Like I said that I write chords, melody, lyrics. Sometimes if I can't come up with a melody, I'll try and write lyrics and try and fit the melody to it. I'll try and like switch it around. I think it's about both letting go of like your structure and also just sometimes you gotta step away. I have a song on my second EP, Finding Foundations Volume 2, called Shine, and I think that song took me like 6 months to write the lyrics. And it was a thing where I was getting frustrated that I wasn't coming up with anything. And then once it got to the point of me letting go of whatever ideals I had, that's when it turned into something. So I think a lot of it comes down to letting go of whatever you think you're holding on to, because then you can actually like open your mind to accept what is supposed to happen, if that makes sense.
Thank you.
Who else? Oh, yes, over there. Or, yeah, where are we going?
Thank you. Hi, name is Tara.
And hi, Tara.
Thank you for this beautiful series.
Well, thank you for coming.
So my question is, you said that your words are an extension of your melody. Have you ever read something or written something and kind of pulled a melody out of that, or vice versa?
Yeah, it doesn't generally happen that way. It usually, if lyrics come before the melody, it's usually the case that it comes together. Like, it's a thing where it's like, I usually write the melody first and then lyrics come, but then sometimes lyrics and melody happen at the same time. But it, with the exception of like my very first song, it hasn't really been the case that the lyrics come first. I think it's because of the fact that, like, even listening to songs now, sometimes it'll be like a year before I even understand what somebody was even saying in a song, and I know all the words to the song, because for me, the words don't register in the same way as the melody does. So when I say like my lyrics are an extension of my melody, like it really is that I'm like fitting in words that I think sound like the melody in my head. And like I said to Vanessa, it's a thing where sometimes when I get stuck, I'll try and write the words first, and that can help like get around some stuff. But it takes me so long to actually like register a lot of lyrics of other people's music, and not because I don't care, but just because I am so attuned to sound that like I'm dissecting like what's happening in the bass and what's happening in the drums and like what are all these other sounds that are happening, and the lyrics themselves are a sound. Like when Lady Marmalade came out, the cover, not the original, I remember for the longest time I was singing Keep Your Lady Mama Alive. Like that was like what I was singing, and that's just because that's what it sounded like. Or like all I have very good retention of a lot of lyrics, but I think it's just because I have good retention of melody and like that fits together. And I'll sing along to the in the car to a song that maybe came out when I was like 8, and I'll realize that like I'm not even saying words, I'm like saying absolute gibberish that in my mind made total sense when I was 8. I thought that what's that song from Greece, You're the One That I Want, for some reason I thought that they were saying a waddle in a puddle. I don't know what that means, but that's what it sounded like, so I went with it, and then that was clearly incorrect. So yeah, whenever it comes to writing lyrics first, that usually just happens if I'm challenging myself, because I never want to force lyrics into a melody that doesn't work, because I love playing with melody, and I love how melody dances around chords, and that for me is far more important than anything else. And it's like I can figure out what words fit to that melody. It's much harder for me personally to fit a melody around words. I figure that the words that I want to say and how I want to convey them will manifest themselves in whatever melody soundscape I create. So does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Oh, thank you. Who is next? One more.
Hi. My name is Ingrid.
Hi, Ingrid.
I would love to know, where does your inspiration comes from? Is through your live experience, or you were telling stories through your song?
Like, my inspirations for songwriting?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of it comes from, it's definitely life experience, and not just my own life experience, but like the experiences around me, you know? And I really try and be intentional with what I'm saying, because I am aware that words have so much power, and I want to make sure that I'm not just like saying a bunch of BS that doesn't matter. And I think that also comes with the fact that, like, I get a little disappointed by the current state of popular music, just in terms of the lyrical content. And I admire so much the storytellers of, you know, Stevie Wonder and Aretha Franklin, although she didn't really write a lot of her songs, but the people who wrote these songs back in the 60s and 70s, the Beatles, you know, they're a huge inspiration of mine. Building this story that actually, like, has meaning, and knowing that music is so powerful. A lot of people refer to it as, like, the universal language. I've traveled around the world, and, like, people who don't know anything I'm saying still connect with my music. My father barely sings words, and, like, people love him, you know? But I think it's because there's that connection. And so, knowing that music is so powerful, I want to ensure that the lyrics are a part of that. And so I really just try and draw from what I'm feeling. It's very personal. All of my music is very personal, even when it's about, when I'm trying to write about other things, because the way that I look at it, no one is experiencing any emotion for the first time in the history of history. You know, it's like, I'm not the first person to experience love or heartbreak or anything. And so it's a mode of being able to, even when I'm just talking about myself, I'm talking about everybody else, because I'm not experiencing life in an isolated bubble. I'm not feeling my feelings in an isolated bubble, as much as it can feel like that. Particularly now, it seems like we all feel so isolated. So I draw from my own life experiences, knowing that it's going to resonate to other people, if that makes sense. Sweet. I think I'm going to do my acapella version now, if that's cool. So this is, I when I made the acapella version, just a quick side note, I had to figure out how I was going to transfer this to that. And so the hardest part is always figuring out how I'm going to sequence it, like in what layers. So I knew that I wanted to do the bass line first. But then I gotta figure out where I'm gonna jump to, you know? So it's like I have to figure out each line going line by line. And that's probably my favorite thing to do, because it is so tough. It's easier when I do it on a piano, because then I can be like, oh, I gotta jump to this note, then this note, then this note. But when I write apart from the piano, deconstructing loops to reconstruct them and figure out what is the best order, because it's like there might be an interval that I have to jump that is just really difficult and hard to hear. And so that's always my favorite part. So I'm going to reconstruct it in the acapella version. We're going to go over here now. New microphone, same person. For my ladies out there, you guys ever wear a shirt that just makes your bra strap fall down all the time? I don't know what that's about. Let's see. What is happening? Hello? Ooh, we got some echo. That's not supposed to be there. Let's see, hold on. Dun, dun. Here we go. So this is Know You Better, the acapella version. Dun, 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 da 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 dun, dun.
tables are turning. Must be the speed. Scared me over observing. Honey, I
an incredible comedian, Lorelai Ramirez. Lorelai is an artist, comedian, and writer whose credits include Adult Swim, The Chris Gethard Show, and Vice's The Creators Project, where they write about art and comedy. Lorelai, a self-published author and host, they host a monthly show at Manhattan Inn called Not Dead Yet, which I did a couple years ago. And it was amazing, and I became obsessed with them because they are hilarious. So give a round of applause for Lorelai Ramirez.
Very cool. So happy to be here. How's everyone doing? Cool. This seems like a very nice, feel-good show, so I'm sorry to disappoint you now. So I'm just going to do... Okay. So I'm just going to do, like, impression, right? So you can get my, like, general vibe. And if you don't like that, feel free to walk out for the rest of the show, because it will be 10 minutes of this vibe, okay? Keep eye contact, please, when I'm looking at you. Okay, all right, so here's an impression. I'm I was a master impressionist. I came to New York to be on SNL. I had this, like, before Crazy Frog, I, like, made up a little character called Crazy Frog. Anyway, it's just, like, complicated now, so I... They didn't let me be on it when Crazy Frog came out. But I have trained a lot of other Crazy Frog impressionists and some people who have auditioned for SNL. So I'm pretty legit. So here's an impression. See if you can guess what it is.
Hey, mister. I could suck your dick if you want me to.
That is whatever you want it to be. I'm kind of the only comedian in the world that does comedy for everybody. You know, every single type of person out there. Imagine there's like a ton of, am I allowed to say that? Pedophiles waiting out there.
Yes.
You can hear them whispering.
Yes, Lorelai, keep representing us. People seem to forget about us, but we run the world. Yes, 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 yes. Ooh, Jeffrey Epstein. Talk about him. Oh, talk about Michael Jackson's island.
They're giving me ideas. And then they start talking about other stuff. They're like,
talk about flowers, daisies. We love daisies. Yes.
They start singing. A beautiful song comes from there. But it sounds like Madison's song. You're like, wait, what is that? And then we open the curtain, it's like a bunch of them. That would suck. Imagine like if it was a fact that all pedophiles had beautiful operatic voices. And so like when you go into a jail filled with them, you hear like beautiful music. And you're like, oh, this is kind of nice. And then you listen to the lyrics. It's like, if only I could love a child. No! But he does sing well. All right, what do we really want to talk about? 2020. 2020, I've decided I'm a teacher. Okay? So... Okay? So I'm a teacher, 2020. Dr. Phil's not a real doctor, but he's called Dr. Phil. So I can be a teacher. The medical medium, do you know about him? It's a guy who talks to ghosts and he can tell when people have cancer. Anyway, he's like a bestseller and stuff. So I'm a teacher now. So we're going to, I have a question for you guys. Do you guys believe in magic? Magic, not out of a hat, magic CK, right? The woo-woo stuff. Do you guys believe in that? Yeah? Who believes in it? Put your hands up. Be strong. Okay, who doesn't believe in it? Put your hands up, be strong. Don't be shy. Up, all the way up. Non-believers. Non-believers in magic, okay? Up, you did this and then you pretended, no, I could see you. No, stop, okay? No, you're a man. I don't know. I hope I got it right, is what I meant. Okay, you up all the way? Up all the way. Keep it up. Be proud. Non-magic believers. No magic. CK, you're like, yeah, right, bullshit. Up, all the way, okay. Okay, can I ask you why you don't believe in magic? CK, you know, witchcraft, magic, occult, woo, whoa. That, oh, no, 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 no. The thing when you mention it, people are like, oh, I gotta get away from you. You know that stuff? You don't believe in it. Okay. Okay, so we made a believer tonight. You don't believe in it. You believe in science. Okay, perfect. I love where this is going. Science. Okay. That is one of my... I hate when people say, I don't believe in magic, but I believe in science. What do you think science is? It's really rational and like... logical. Okay, so just off the top of your head, because it's like really rational and logical, can you give him the formula for cheese? I thought it was rational. I think that scientists are witches. That's my thing. I'm just going crazy up here, 2020, going crazy. Scientists are witches! Like foaming by the mouth. Somebody's watching this somewhere, scared. Scientists are witches. They're playing with like genetic structure in a lab, tonics, making tonics, blue tonics. They have little lab coats. Let's just change it up. Wear the pointy hats. Wear the pointy hats, show yourselves. Any scientists in here tonight? Scientists, put your hands up, scientists. You're a scientist? Oh my God. Well, we got to talk later. We really need to talk. I'm just, you know, I'm talking about, my argument for magic is real. I think magic is actually a very practical thing. I think the woo-woo part of it needs to go. It's very practical. Think about humans, right? Think about our ability to make anything happen, okay? Let's think about very practical things. Okay, we've got highways. Wow. Came out of nowhere. There used to be trees in the way. Now there are systems. What? Light bulbs. It used to be dark. Now there is light. Wow. Gourmet food. How did we get there? That one I don't know. Like how did it start? Like a, imagine like, I don't know, like a Neanderthal was just kind of going around and like with a, like a rotten piece of meat, like looking for something to put on it because he was bored. Puts a little leaf on it, presents it to the group with like very good intentions, like a very tender face, like nimbled on it a little bit, was like, this is a good idea. Everyone's gonna like it. And then, because it was like innovative, they probably killed him. You know? Although he had the best intentions. How many people had to die before we got to gourmet food? Anyway, I'm just trying to get to, we're, you know, we're all crazy, okay? And magic is real. But if we start thinking about it, like what is, like, what do we define as normal, you know? Like, let's, maybe we can go down the line, like a suit, that's normal. Briefcase, pretty normal if you carry that around, if you have a job. If you wear a scarf in the winter, that's pretty normal. If you, I don't know, you like have a house and in the basement, you like have a computer where you download child pornography, that's pretty normal, like on the down low. Like a private island where you keep your like sex trafficking victims, that's pretty normal. What else is normal? Oh, believing that a man from the sky will save us all. That a fetus has consciousness is normal. That all sounds really crazy to me. Like, insane. So a lot of you are in here. You're like, I can't believe the goal. So I think, I'm just saying, I think we can redefine what normal is, you know? I feel like we have a lot of power, and it's so easy to make someone like extremely powerless by just saying, you suck. Doesn't that feel bad? If I just, you suck. Doesn't it feel good when I'm like, you're great? Isn't that insane? Like, imagine if we all felt, I don't know, if we all like really felt our power, like how much change we could enact, you know? Maybe we'll do something right now and using our power. Maybe we use our power for bad. And we make, I'm sorry to pick on you again. What's your name? Luis. Hi, nice to meet you, I'm Lorelai. Okay, we're just gonna do this for the sake of the show. It doesn't mean anything, but I'll just come back and whisper something nice to you so that you don't leave with a bad feeling. Okay, but we're gonna make you feel really, really bad. Just to prove that it works, okay. Just be open to it. All right, so everybody, close your eyes, please. If you don't close your eyes, I will put my face in your face. Okay. Close your eyes. Eyes closed, please. Eyes closed. Eyes closed. Closed eyes, please. Everybody, closed eyes. Good, good. Okay, so with your eyes closed, I want you to think of someone you hate. I know you're not supposed to hate anybody, but you do. We're angry. There's a lot to hate. There are people who don't want to change. Oh, God, I feel this. So dark. Feels heavy. There's a heaviness in our heart, in our chests. Okay, now we're going to remember Luis. And we're sending Luis this negative energy. We have to do this. This is a scientific stuff. I'm a scientist. I'm a teacher. And we're going to say, you hurt me, Luis. Oh, God. Now there's laughter. You hurt me, Luis. Okay? Keep your eyes closed. Keep thinking about that other person. On the count of three, okay? Towards Luis. You're going to send it to him. He's agreed for you to send it to him. You've agreed. On the count of three. One, two, three. You hurt me, Luis. Now open your eyes. You released it. How do you feel, Luis? Everybody wants you to drink. You feel like drinking? Please drink. Okay, so now's the part where I come back. And so I just want to tell you, I think you're a really good guy. I think that you have a very kind soul, that your tattoos are really cool. Your pants are cool, style's cool. You probably have done amazing things in your life. And I want to thank you for being here and for being open to having people hate you for a second. I think that takes a lot of bravery and a lot of guts. So you're very brave. If there was like an annihilation, you know the movie? Have you watched Annihilation? Okay, so there's like this thing called the shimmer, and it's like really far away, but it's coming closer, and there's scientists. I have to go over there to like get it and stuff, and it's like very scary. But if like they made a team of scientists and I had to follow somebody, and they were like, who wants to be on Luis's team? I'd be like, yes, I'd be on Luis's team. So just want to let you know that, yeah. I don't know how much time I've been up here, but really that's all I wanted to talk about. Just wanted to talk about, you know, owning your power, how we can easily be bad. I do have a new impression. I'm sorry, can you tell that I just got up? Like, got out of bed screaming, walked here, and now I'm like, Here's an impression. See if you can guess what it is. It's a new one. It's one for 2020. I think it's really good. Okay, here we go. It's an oyster. Did you feel like the oyster vibes? It's more like a live, like experiential one. You know, like it wouldn't translate to like vinyl or anything, but it's definitely like a live bit. It's all about like the timing, you know? Can you just imagine an oyster? Most of these things are just things I think about when I'm like, I'm gonna kill myself. And I'm like, oyster. I'm around the house, no pants on. Oh my God. I really don't know how much time I've been up here. I can be here forever? Hey. Oh, well, you know, I'll do this one other one. You didn't have to do that. I like how like the stage people in any place, it's like, we can see you. And you guys are like, it's like, you're visible. You're making yourselves more visible. Oh. Okay, this is another one I was thinking about when I was really like depressed. I was like eating vegan food that I made myself and I started laughing just thinking about like if I made vegan food for my friends and I actually put like butter and milk and ice cream in it, like just a little bit, like not enough for taste, but like just like that I put it. But I was laughing at like if I thought that was like if I had the best intentions, you know? And then I thought about like a vegan restaurant, maybe it's like a really famous one in the city. And then people go to the back, like maybe raid it or something. And there's like an Italian chef and he's like, you know, oh no, no. Oh no, 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 no. Like when they find him out and he's got like buckets of ice cream and like butter and stuff. And he's been putting just a little bit. He's just like, oh, just a little. I thought it would have been a good idea, just a little bit. I'd feel so bad for him. But it made me laugh so hard, and then they take him to jail. No, 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 my pizza, my pizza. Oh, no, 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 please. It made me laugh really hard. And we think he's a good guy the whole time, but he's not. You catch him like masturbating in the jail to like a picture that he drew of like butter. It's like, you're sick. And he's like, no, 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 it's not what I look like. And then he does it to you. Oh no, he's bad. This is all not real. I love when an audience comes along with me and they're like, oh no, how could he do that? And I'm like, none of this has happened. All right, thank you so much. Love you guys.
Give it up for Lorelai Ramirez. I love them so much. I also love that they make people very uncomfortable. And I think that we need more of that nowadays. We've gotten a little too comfortable. Make America uncomfortable again, I think is, well, you know, actually that is very successful. That has since happened. I think we are all quite uncomfortable. So, Lorelai, amazing. Real quick before I introduce the final artist for this evening, I want to give it up for DJ Reborn, who's been spinning on the ones and twos. Also, lovely shout out to Gizmo, who is vending vintage out front. I myself like to, I do my best to shop exclusively secondhand or vintage.
vintage, because, you know, the climate, we've got enough shit, people. Just, like, wear some old shit, okay? It's not that difficult. We don't all need to be wearing the same thing either. So let's switch it up. Let's be good to the environment. I'm into it. So this is our last performer. Thank you again for being here. I really appreciate it for the last of the Sissieretta series with WNYC. Thank you, WNYC, for having me. And give it up for, we've got the beautiful work of Whitney creating this like lovely living room space, you know, hey, with these wonderful plants that I will promptly be returning to Home Depot. Because you can do that, you got 90 days. Just so you know, if you didn't know that, you can return plants to Home Depot 90 days. After 90 days, it's store credit. So I think Home Depot will still be open after this. So, you know, one and done. Little secrets, how to make a stage look nice. So our final performer, this is Duendita. She is an amazing vocalist. She's New York based. And last year she released her debut album, Direct Line to My Creator, Pitchfork. They called her a gateway to the divine. Yeah. That's big. That's big. So give it up for Duendita, everybody.
Professor, do you swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth to help you, God?
I do.
Thank you. Professor, please make whatever statement you wish to make to the committee.
Chill. Hey! This space. Shout out to Madison. Can we give it up for Madison one more time? Shout out to everybody who commutes to work in New York City. Can we give it up to all the commuters? If you commute to work, shout out to you. I'm commuting somewhere. I'm taking some sort of journey in life, and that's messed up, man. I'm gonna just keep going because I love to sing. Maybe not that song. Maybe this song. Called Mine.
Oh, babe.
Let's see what happens.
Fear feels tall in my mind, in my mind, in my mind. Purple paranoid, reaching within for joy, lost and emotional. Oh no, 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 no.
Can you put my synth up, please?
Thank you.
Oh,
dream of flying away, away,
away.
Try to escape the sky, feel blue but don't know why. Light man's a lullaby, tears falling from my eyes. Oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh, oh,
found a song that I want to share. If that's okay with you. I always find songs on my SP that I love that I forgot about. A lot of cool themes came up today in today's show. Thinking a lot about power. I don't want power, but I was born with it. So how do I deal with that? Interesting. This song is called Break the Silence. I wrote it like all these other songs that I'm playing, but this song, I produced it and it sounds really good to me. It's the first song that I made that I really like in the heart. So I'm playing it.
I can't take this shit.
Can't handle it.
Different day,
still face the pain, won't go away, no.
That's the way I gotta get out, I'ma need the whole way around to me. A little more kind to me, a little more kind to we. I'll have a new uplift, those that
But they don't want to do that. They want me to get ugly. They want me to waste my energy. I'm good. You know who the f*** I is? I'm the Puerto Rican princess. It's gonna take God to come down here and slow me down. They want me to get ugly. They want me to waste my energy. They want. I'm good.
Here we are, you know, here's the pain. My, oh my, I want
someone wants to tell me. If I'm right, now would be a good time. Cool. Thanks, Meg.
Give it up for Twendita, everybody. Bam, 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 bam. Yeah. It was great. They were using an angle from the top, which we haven't seen, and you were, no, it was amazing. Give it up for Twendita, everybody. So we're going to close out the show the way that we started, with some poetry. So, you know, get your minds ready, relax yourselves. But thank you guys so much for being here. I really appreciate it. I'm so grateful for each and every one of you for coming out to this series. Thank you for supporting women of color. It's really important to have each and every one of you in this room. Again, DJ Reborn, we've got Gizmo outside. Give it up for Lorelei and Duendita once again. Thank you, WNYC, for having me as your artist in residence. I'm so grateful. You can make sure to follow all of these people on the socials and whatnot, you know, if you don't already, because that's like art currency now, whatever. You can follow me at Mad McFerrin. Not Madison McFerrin, because that's like an 18-year-old in Wisconsin. I get Google alerts for her. She just got on the basketball team. So props to Madison McFerrin in Wisconsin. Scored 10 points last week, so, you know, it's great. I'm playing at Winter Jazz Fest on Friday night, so you should come through if you're free. I play at 1 a.m., so, you know, drink that coffee, you know what I'm saying? So give it up for our final performer, Zubita. She's gonna do some incredible poetry for you guys, and then I'll be out front. Come say hi. You know, we can chat if you had questions that you were too scared to ask before. You know, you can do that. I'm gonna change my shirt because this silk is really holding in all the heat. But thank you guys so much for being here. I really appreciate it. So this is our last performer. Thank you guys.
Black and angry are not synonyms. I know this because I'm the proof. I don't always write angry poems or sad poems or anything that may make white people uncomfortable. Sometimes I get bold, release my happiness like a convict, talk that Brooklyn shit, the same way flapper streets speak with a Trinidad tongue twisted twang and Subway Showtime shouts simultaneously, the same way the sun bounces off Bed-Stuy brownstones and exposes the halos on all the black boys throwing their bodies around like basketballs. The same way Canarsie streets stay hard, no matter how many times gentrification comes knocking, disguised as liberals wearing black Birkenstocks and white privilege, no matter how many times catcalls force me to drag my body, dead weight under coat and shame. Fine. Maybe I do get a little angry talking about Brooklyn, but food makes me happy. Plantains from the Caribbean spot, yuca from the Dominicans, drowned under jollof rice and fried chicken. It's so good. I almost forget I live in a food desert, like 23 million others. But that's fine, since homicide is the leading cause of death in African Americans. No, I'm not mad about that either. I don't have time to be. Not when the life expectancy for black women is the lowest in the country. Not when the earth is set to disappear by 2030, submerged in water, greenhouse gases, and mass capitalism. Not when mass shootings happen every other month and we coddle the white terrorists. Send them our thoughts and prayers, our love and light, and further wash out the already muted wails of black mothers. Ignore the black girls trapped in R. Kelly's closet, and anywhere else, our pain becomes the background noise to just another morning. Still, I hope none of this makes you uncomfortable. That's my main priority, making sure my injustice doesn't encroach upon your happiness. Who cares that black women only earn 70 cents to every white man's dollar? Who cares that black women are most likely to become victims of domestic violence? Who cares about black women when this country was built on our backs without our permission? This isn't an angry poem. This is a I have a right to be angry poem. This is a I will not be silenced poem. This is an impassioned black woman poem. I'm not angry. I'm scared that I will vanish under the streetlights. We've seen this magic trick before, that my word selfie will become the picture for my Amber Alert, that even if I stay silent, there are other stereotypes to keep me chained and docile. I'm scared that even as I rip out my beating heart and lay it on this stage, people will throw the word angry at me like a cheap band-aid. So excuse me if I get a little emotional, if my voice rings louder than your complacency, if I'm too much to muzzle. Sometimes the fight to live sounds a lot like anger, and I'm just trying to be heard. Thank you.